Hello everyone, this is online lecture 1 of the course Network Control Systems. Today's title is Introduction to Control of Network Systems. First, let's see the example of network systems in our lives. In fact, a lot of network systems can be found in the real world. For example, power networks, social networks, water networks, urban traffic networks. These are common examples of large-scale network systems. These systems actually have common features. For example, these are time-varying and dependent on human behavior or human actions. So, these are uncertain systems in the sense that those may vary with uncertain human behaviors. The main topic and the main focus of this course is to control of these kind of large-scale network systems. Next, let's think about how to control such large-scale network systems. Here, I give a rough history of control theory. First, in 1868, Maxwell did stability analysis of dynamical systems, particularly for mechanical governor here. This is recognized as the beginning of control theory. And then, in 1950s, classical control theory has been developed mainly for SISO systems, namely single input, single output systems. This is based on transfer function models described in the frequency domain. Then, in 1960s to 1970s, modern control theory has been developed. This is based on state space models, which can handle MIMO systems. After 1980s, robust control theory and many other theories have been developed. In the current systems and control, we use the mixture of transfer function and state space models. This means that we use both frequency domain analysis and the time domain analysis. In fact, these standard control theories can be applied to mechanical systems such as a governor, which is small enough to be managed by a single engineer or manager. However, they are difficult to apply to network systems such as power systems. This is because those systems are too large to be handled by a single engineer. So, as you can see here, standard control theory, which generally assumes the centrality of design and implementation, is difficult to apply to control of large-scale network systems. This is the main concern in this course. In fact, similar concerns have been discussed already about 40 years ago. From IEEE Explorer, we can find a survey paper on decentralized control for large-scale systems published in the IEEE Pre-Transactions on Automatic Control. In this old paper, the authors say that all of these existing control design procedures rest on the common presupposition of centrality. In this paper, the centrality is discussed for these two points. The first one is concerned with the information about system models. On the other hand, the second one is concerned with the sensor information about system responses. It is also interesting to note that in this old paper, as typical example of large-scale systems, power networks, urban traffic networks, digital communication networks are listed. In fact, we still have the same concerns as those in about 40 years ago. Okay, let's see more about the two centralities in the previous slides. The first centrality is concerned with the information about system models. In fact, This centrality corresponds to the centrality in design phase. This can be seen as follows. For large-scale physical systems, such as power systems, we may obtain some output data from distributed sensor like this. From such big data of sensor output information, we can do modeling and analysis of the system to get a high-dimensional cyber model here. However, such a high-dimensional model is difficult to use because it is too heavy to compute a desirable controller. In addition, please note that it is actually difficult to obtain an entire system model for large-scale systems. Maybe you can easily imagine that it is not easy to obtain a power network model because it is spatially distributed in a large area. On the other hand, the second centrality is on sensor information about system responses, which corresponds to implementation phase of decentralized controllers. For large-scale systems, we need distributed sensing and actuation to realize an actual implementation of controllers. In fact, such distributed sensing and actuation is difficult to implement by a single centralized controller. As we see here, it is important to distinguish these two centralities on design phase and implementation phase. Just for reference, we introduce another review article on decentralized control published in Annual Reviews in Control 2008. In this paper, slightly different terminologies are used, such as decentralization of process and decentralization of control law. However, we can actually see that the same concerns about the centralities of design and the implementation are discussed also in this relatively new review article published in 2008. At almost the same time, another review article has been published in Annual Reviews in Control entitled Control of Large-Scale Systems Beyond Decentralized Feedback. The main concern in this paper is about the limitation of classical decentralized control having a block diagonal structure like this. This block diagonal structure corresponds to no communication among controllers. So such a strict control structure may impose the limitation of control performance. Then, this paper proposes a design method of controllers having an overlapping structure like this. This overlapping structure corresponds to partial communication among controllers, and such controllers having a partial communication are often called a distributed controller. From this age, a distributed control scheme became a major approach of large-scale systems control. Here, let's clarify the terminology on information structure of controllers used in this course. First, the centralized controller is a controller having no particular structure inside the controller. Second, the decentralized controller is a controller such that each subcontroller is attached to each subsystem like this, which has no communication among subcontrollers. On the other hand, the distributed controller has partial communication among subcontrollers like this. Note that these three kinds of controllers can be applied to network systems described as the block diagram here, which corresponds to a power network, for example. On the other hand, for multi-agent systems having no communication among agents, a distributed cooperative controller can be applied. Here, this distributed cooperative controller can produce a communication among the agents. Please also note that I think this terminology may be standard in systems and control, but sometimes different terminologies may be used depending on authors. As explained in the previous slide, the control objectives are generally different for decentralized control and distributed cooperative control. This is illustrated like this. In the decentralized control, the subsystems sigma 1, sigma 2, sigma 3 represent some areas in power systems, for example. Then the subcontrollers K1, K2, K3 are designed for respective areas for local control. While for distributed cooperative control, the subsystem sigma 1, sigma 2, sigma 3 represent each agent, and the distributed controller represents a communication rule among agents. This realizes a desirable coordination of agents. Please note such a difference of applications. This slide shows the recent trends from statistics. To overview the history of decentralized and distributed control, I searched the titles of all the published papers in IEEE Transactions on Automatic Control. This is to count the number of papers, including keywords shown here. The blue bar corresponds to the decentralized control. To better find related papers, the keywords such as modular, modularity, modularized are collected in this category. The red bar corresponds to distributed cooperative control, including the keywords of merge agent, consensus cooperative, distributed optimization. The yellow corresponds to the papers that are especially concerned with the centrality of design process of controllers. Then, the result is shown in this graph. As we can see here, the number of papers discussing distributed cooperative control shown in red is increasing after the year 2000, while the number of papers discussing decentralized control is gradually increasing, as shown in blue. Also, it is interesting to remark that, as shown in yellow, only a few papers discuss the decentralization of the design process of controllers. From these statistics, we can say that quite a large number of papers are actually concerned with the centrality of implementation, while only a small number of papers are concerned with the centrality of design. In a long history of decentralized and distributed control, a number of fundamental and striking results have been obtained. Of course, it is not possible to review all the existing results, so I selected here several publications to cover a variety of topics. In particular, I will explain these two results in blue as distributed cooperative control, while these four results in red as those of decentralized control. The first result is the consensus of merge agents. As a readable tutorial article, I uploaded a paper of proceedings of the IEEE in 2007 as this link. A standard consensus problem is very simple, but it has a lot of applications such as coordination of robots and the synchronization of clocks in distributed sensors. The simplest case is a network of integrators described as like this. This network system can be represented as a block diagram here. In this block diagram, the block L represents a communication rule of agents. A local description of the communication rule is given like this. The input of the ICE integrator is given as the difference between its states and that of the neighboring agents. The resultant L becomes a graph reproduction matrix So the consensus of all agent states is achieved if the network system is stable. In fact, the system is always stable if all connections are bidirectional. The consensus algorithm can be extended by using the notion of passivity. The passivity is an important notion in network systems control, and it will be discussed also in this course in detail. The control objectives are illustrated here. Suppose that at the initial condition, each agent has different velocity and it is distant from other agents. Then we aim at designing a local communication rule such that as time goes, all agents share the same velocity within a small distance denoted by epsilon here. These are mathematically written like this A and B. In fact, if the agent dynamics is passive or pacificated by a local feedback control, we can design a passive communication rule to achieve the control objectives given above. Similar to the case of simple consensus, each agent exchanges the information about the difference of states with its neighbors. In this method, this blue block corresponds to a design parameter of the passive distributed controller. The major advantage of passivity is that the negative feedback of passive systems like this red block and this green block is always stable, so the consensus can be guaranteed in a systematic manner. Next, let's move on to the review of decentralized control. Professor Shiroyaki is famous in systems and control as a pioneer of a number of results for large-scale systems control. One of the fundamental but important results is on the connective stability. The connective stability is concerned with the structural perturbation of subsystem interconnection. For example, as in this block diagram, let's suppose that the interconnection among subsystems is represented by gamma. Then the full network system here is said to be connectively stable if it is stable for all the value of gamma belonging to the value of 0 to 1. Please note that if gamma is 0, then the subsystem is to be disconnected from the network system. So the connective stability is concerned with the network system's stability and the plug-in and the plug-out of the subsystems. For particular stability condition derived, please see this reference uploaded here. In 2006, a striking paper was published in the IEEE Transactions on Automatic Control. That paper proposes a notion called quadratic invariance, which can be used to characterize the convexity of distributed controller design problems. A general distributed controller design problem can be written like this optimization, where the impact of the disturbance D to the evaluation output Z is minimized such that the stabilizing controller K is constrained by a subspace S, which represents an information structure constraint, namely a sparsity constraint of controllers. The definition of the quadratic invariance of the information structure S is given like this. If S is quadratically invariant, then the original optimization problem here can be equivalently represented as a convex problem like this. The convexity of optimization is very important because the global optimization solution can be found, for example, using an existing convex optimization algorithm. It is valuable to remark that an interesting negative result was also derived in this paper. That is, the decentralized control is never quadratically invariant unless G is block diagonal, which means that the all subsystems are disjoint. This result actually proves that solving a decentralized control problem is very difficult for general network systems. Okay, I give you the first homework here. In fact, what to do is very simple. Prove that this optimization is a convex optimization. I give you necessary hints and the document as follows. Let's try to write down a clear mathematical proof to show the convexity of this optimization. Let's see another negative result. This is on the topic of distributed design, where the authors particularly discuss the notion of distributed design, namely the decentralization of design process of controllers. In fact, this paper is not concerned with decentralized or distributed control, but it is concerned with the communication-less design of a full state feedback controller such that the ith state feedback is designed only by the local model AI of the ith subsystem. The main result in this paper is to show that for any possible controller case circle here, which is obtained by communication-less design, there exists some Plant model such that the quadratic performance index J becomes arbitrarily large. This means that any communication-less design is not versatile, so we need to devise a tailored design process of controllers depending on which target system we want to control. As we have seen in the previous slides, the decentralized control problems are generally difficult to handle. In particular, the decentralization of design process of controllers is more difficult than the centralized design of the controllers. As a new approach to this difficult problem, our research group is now developing a modular design theory of decentralized controllers called retrofit control. An illustration is given here. For large-scale network systems, such as power systems, each subsystem manager is supposed to have only their own subsystem model like this. Then, each subsystem manager aims at designing their local controller K while regarding the remaining part of the network system as an unknown environment, denoted by G bar. Note that other managers' actions are also involved in the environment. The key point of this problem formulation is that the pre-existing system before retrofit control, represented by this blue box, is assumed to be stable or stabilized in advance. Such an assumption is actually valid in practice because, as you know, a practical large-scale system, such as a power system, is currently operated in a stable manner now, as the integration of existing control techniques. Under this special assumption, the retrofit controller is defined as a controller such that the entire feedback system is kept stable for any possible variation of environment G bar. Please note that the retrofit controller is not a stabilizing controller for unstable systems, but it is a stability-preserving controller for stable systems. Focusing on this special problem formulation, we can develop a particular controller having several good properties for decentralized control. Finally, let's overview the contents of this course. In the first two lectures, we will see the model set-based system analysis and synthesis, which is based on the notion of passivity in the frequency domain. Then, in the next lecture, a distributed optimization-based control schemes will be explained. The last two lectures will explain the details of retrofit control in both the time domain and the frequency domain. All these materials are introduced for handling the difficulty of large-scale systems, such as dimensionality, information structure constraints, and uncertainty. Please enjoy this course.